Hello, everybody. Welcome to a new episode of Follow Your Passion. And I would like to introduce my guest, Lillian Brummett. Lillian and her husband, Dave, have been writing professionally since 1999. To date, they have 6 published books, including the recently released From One Small Garden, over 300 delicious, nutritious recipes. They also run 2 popular blogs, the Brummett's Conscious blog since 2004, and more recently, Drummett with Brummett for drummers and percussionists. And that's more Dave's part. They're not only stars in writing. Lillian and Dave also produced and hosted the online Conscious Discussions radio show for 10 years that broadcasted 3 times per week for an hour. And Lillian also produced and hosted the Authors Read radio show for 2 years. The main focus of their work is to inspire hope in individuals, helping people realize the value of their efforts and encouraging them to become more positive and proactive in their life. And that's the very reason why I love to have Lillian in my show. Welcome, Lillian. How are you doing?
Hi, Erwin. Hi to everyone that's joining us today. Thank you so much for dropping in and visiting with us for this great conversation. I'm so looking forward to this.
Yeah. So, Lillian, you and your husband, Dave, have been writing professionally since 1999 already.
Yeah.
How did you found this passion together? That I don't hear it that often that spouses are having the same passion and sharing the same hobby, career, how would you like to call it?
Yeah, working with your spouse is unusual. A lot of people ask us that question because people imagine that it's going to put more stress on the relationship, working with your spouse, especially in the world of writing and in the world of arts in particular, because it's such a high competition and everyone has their own unique views about it. It's a very interesting genre to be working together in. I started working in the world of writing back in 1999. My husband was already teaching music. And of course, he had been performing music all over BC and as house bands and what have you. And he was starting to and being a studio drummer. And so he was already taking on students at that point. And we had a side business going on with that. I was also running my own business. I was servicing high-end clientele that lived along on the lake. Mm-hmm. And I had done that for about 6 years. I started the business from scratch, but I got involved in a 3-car pileup accident. I was in the middle. And that sent me into physiotherapy for over a year, about a year and a half. I was in physiotherapy 5 days a week for the first year and part-time the second year, slowly working myself away from those services. And that changed my life completely. For one thing, it took a lot for me to get to the point of running that business. You know, I'd been on my own when I was really young. I'd put myself through school, college, you know, learn about business, take the business courses, launch the business. It wasn't just, you know, starting it with, you know, handouts and help along the way. It was all by myself. And then to have that, what I felt like at the time, the universe ripped that away from me, stole that away from me. And I felt really vulnerable. I felt worthless. I felt like all the work that I put into, you know, fit in and be one of the white picket fencers out there, you know, with the Leave It to Beaver families. I wanted to be one of them. And so I felt like all of that had been undermined. And I went into chronic. I spiraled right into chronic depression between the chronic pain, all the appointments, the stress, the panic disorder that came out of the accident. And then, you know, to deal with losing your business. So that was such a traumatic event for me that I didn't really feel like I wanted to go forward in life. I was really at the end. And so I had these conversations with my husband and I said, you know, this is where I'm at. I don't know where to go. I'm desperate. So I went and I talked to some specialists, some coaches out there, and they helped me understand that really deep down what I needed to fulfill myself was to feel like every action that I had taken had left a positive impact, so that if something should change tomorrow, I could look back on yesterday and I can feel gratified that my work had done something, that I had left a positive mark. Yeah. And so that was really the focus of everything that Dave and I took on at that point, just so happened that there was this amazing writer's course out there. And while writing had come up a lot in my life in the past, I didn't think it was a career choice for me until that point. And so I took that course. It encouraged me to move forward with it. And we have not looked back since. 1999 was when we launched the business together. At that point, about 1999, 2000, right around there, we launched the business together, merged it into one business, and it's just been growing ever since.
Wow, nice. Did writing also help you to overcome this chronic depression?
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. In the past, I had always turned to writing to vent emotions in a way that I felt was very private. I didn't have to share with other people, but I could be really honest on the paper. So paper and I, pen and I, have always gotten along really well. Nice. So it was easy for me to turn to that when it came to looking for solace. While I didn't write about the actual accident or the emotions that I was going through, the writing itself pointed me into, and the direction I wanted to take my writing, leaving a positive legacy, took me into a direction that fed me with all of these amazing people out there in the world. And it showed me that the world is not such a dark place, that there is an incredible amount of love and proactive activity going on every single day, unsung, beautifully out there in the world. And all we have to do is open our eyes and become aware of it. So using my writing, the radio shows, my blogs today, using everything that we can to highlight that kind of activity that's going on in the world in every way that we can, has been such a fulfilling thing for me personally. It staves off the darkness. It helps me get through the darkest of days, when I'm really feeling the pressure of life or bills or something comes into my world or change, you know, that we're not willing to face. And those always, they always pull me through.
Nice. Nice. Mm-hmm. And it also helps to clear your mind if you write things down, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. As a business person, you know, I'm always writing things down. You know, we're creating business plans, we're making notes for the future, we're making alterations to our action plan. I have various files on my desktop where, you know, promotion opportunities or an idea will strike me about, oh, this would be a great networking opportunity. As soon as our schedule opens up for it, I'm always writing things down so that it doesn't weigh down on my mind. And I think, like, oh, all these things to do, I tell myself, oh, I've written it down, I can get to it when my schedule opens. And it gives me a more positive way of looking at it, like, oh, goody, I have all these things to do. Because when you really think about it, a lot of people have to go out there and seek those opportunities. They have to pay someone else to find those opportunities for them. And here, you know, we have 28 pages of, you know, promotional opportunities yet to follow up on. Oh, and wow. You know what I mean? So it makes you feel more empowered about your business. And I think it opens up that creativity. You know, if you make a note of it, maybe you can bring it up when you're having your next, you know, beer on the deck, when you're having your next meeting, and try to figure out where you can go with that idea.
Nice. And it also reminds me when I started my entrepreneurial journey 7 years ago together with my wife. And before that, I was working in the corporate world for about 20 years. Mm-hmm. And the moment we started our entrepreneurial journey together, we started out as hypnotherapist, my wife finally understood what I was doing. And before that, she didn't actually know what I was doing, what my work was, right? But when we started to do similar things, she finally got what I was doing. And it's so helpful to know what the other person is doing, you know, because you can give each other feedback, you know. If you have something in your mind, you can mirror it with your spouse, and it's wonderful. You cooperate, you complement each other, and you can even help each other. And I think that's a beauty. And the fact that you're already doing that since 1999 shows that you're very good at it together.
Well, you know, it's been a learning curve too. You know, you don't just walk into it with a handbook that walks you through it. You have to make some stumbling steps along the way. One of the things that I always recommend that people do when they're entering into a business with any kind of partnership is to have compassion for their other partner and to keep those communication skills open, communication open. So you want to book those weekly meetings. You really do. Even if it's just, you know, meeting for a beer or a coffee or something, sitting down and having the conversation about the business, just the business, is really, really important. Just a loose conversation. How are you feeling about the activities that are on your plate right now? Are you having difficulties? Is there something I can do that can ease your path? What are some of the obstacles that you're facing? Maybe you can help me out with this idea that I'm having and I'm kind of stuck about how to word it, or this communication I'm having, and he might have the right wording, or just the idea that sends me off and I'm running for the keyboard, you know. So having those quick moments, it doesn't take much, but just touching base and, you know, reaffirming where you're at, what challenges each other are facing, how you can help one another. Understand that each other are not going to be at your best every single day. You are not going to be, and neither is he or she that you're partnering with. And so we have to understand that we need to have that kind of compassion. What's going on in their life that's holding them back or causing extra stresses? There's something we can do in that regard. There's also the holding each other accountable. So compassion, yes. And yes, you want to help out as much as you can, but at the same time, you have your own plate. So we have to find that balance, and we are, you know, finding compassion, but having that balance as well, where you were saying, okay, well, you know, this is due. I'm waiting for you. You know, when do you think you can make time in your schedule to make sure this is done? And you just hold each other accountable, I think, is the thing. To hold off with arguments. When you start feeling those pressures come on, and then you're feeling maybe like you want to dump some of your garbage truckload on your partner. You know how sometimes your truckload gets a little full and it's starting to spew out the side. There's some tactful ways of handling that. The best thing to do is to just go aside for a little while and let those emotions cool down. And then you can think about your business maybe in a more, with put your business hat on, not your relationship hat or your emotional hat. You have to sort of set those aside and think about this. Okay, this is our goal, right? This, we're both wanting this goal confirmed. Okay, good. So let's go forward with this. How do we make this happen? And I think that really makes a difference, those communications.
Oh, definitely, definitely. And not only in business, you know, I think if you want to keep your relationship healthy, you should be open and communicate with each other. And I think that's the basis of a very healthy relationship. And if you can combine the two, you know, with also in business, then magic happens.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. If you have someone that you're in business with that's actually a semi-opposite of you, but has the same goal, golden opportunity there. Because in our situation, you know, I'm more of an introvert. I'm much more happier, content here in my home office. I spend most of my days right here in my home office when it comes to the business time. And whereas Dave, he's much more on in person. He's out there making face-to-face contacts. He's the one out there delivering the cookbooks to the bookstores, and that he's doing the in-person networking. He's the one doing the teaching of the drumming and the workshops. I'm behind the scenes running the books, taking the appointments. Yeah. You know, so we make each other up when it comes to the writing. Same thing. I'm the organizer. I tend to do most of the writing in regards to putting it on paper. The creative ideas of what is going to go on that paper is a partnership. We do a lot of brainstorming on that. Once it's done into like a manuscript, then he takes it. It's now in his hands, and he does the final edits, the proofing. He does the formatting, the graphic designing, the book cover. He deals with the publisher, all of that kind of stuff, sets everything up for me to do the marketing, like all the ads, images. And then I can then launch the marketing campaign for that particular product or service. So having that balance, and who's really good at what, who's willing to take these skills on or learn those skills in order to take that particular task on, and to divide it that way, as opposed to trying, like both of you trying to do the same thing all the time. It's better if split off the tasks.
Definitely. And use each other's strengths, you know, to complement each other. And that's perfect. So with regards to the books, you already got 6 published books. The most recent one is a recipe book.
Yes.
But they're not all recipe books, right?
No, they're all in very different genres. And okay, we have a 2-book series that is poetry. Mm-hmm. We have a 2-book series that's in the green living genre. So we talk about not just reducing your waste and reducing your energy, but we look at ways of reusing and repurposing and reconsidering and all kinds of R's that are involved with living a greener lifestyle. So the first book will walk you through every item that you would find in your bin, in your garbage bin at home or office. It explains the recycling system. It shows you alternatives, ways that you can repurpose or reuse that item or donate that item. There's a lot of different organizations in your community and groups that can reuse that item for their projects. And so there's lots of ways of bringing our garbage contribution to the landfill down by a huge amount, just by simple little tiny actions in our homes and offices. And so we empower people by providing that kind of information. And then we have the Purple Snowflake Marketing Book, which is a guide for writers to help them through the whole business aspect of writing, mm-hmm. behind the scenes activities in the office, but also for them to develop a marketing plan for themselves, their business, but for each product or service that they release for the life of that product or service that they're going to have. So
is that the book that you just revised recently?
That's the one we just revised just last year. Yes. Nice. Yes. Yeah, I think it's 370 pages, something like that. It's like,
it's a serious
manual.
Book. Yes. It's a serious book. Yeah.
Yes.
So you updated it with all the new experience and knowledge you gained, probably.
Absolutely. Yeah. It was the previous edition to that, I think, was 2012, I believe, or 2014, something mm-hmm. like that. So there was, you know, a good amount of information that we had learned since then that we were able to update. Marketing is always evolving.
Oh yeah.
And so, you know, while there's all these old school alley cat backdoor guerrilla type marketing activities that one can do, there's also these new opportunities that are happening all the time. So we have to, when we're doing any kind of business activity, we want to make sure that we're balancing that out. We're not just focusing on online ads or we're only doing our blog. You know, we want to have a wide branching marketing plan that is flexible and flows in different areas, different genres, depending on, you know, where you're going, where you're at, what you're promoting. But you definitely want to have multiple fingers out there. And I think that's a real issue for people that are just starting their own business or launching their first book or two, that don't realize that there's more to marketing than just putting some posts up on a Facebook group. You need to get your hands involved, roll up those sleeves, and get a little more proactive in your marketing.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. It's a business itself, right? Doing the correct marketing. Yeah. Wonderful.
Yes. It takes a big part of your business, surprisingly more than you would think if you haven't been an entrepreneur in the past. Those of your listeners who maybe haven't launched yet, there's a lot more behind the scenes activities than you would expect. The organization, the record keeping, the taxes, the communications, then you add the marketing on top of that. And then you have your actual service or your product, right? So there's a lot definitely. Involved behind running your own business.
Yeah, I remember when I started, you know, being great at something doesn't make you an entrepreneur per se. You know, being an entrepreneur involves so many other hats you have to wear. It's amazing. And you only learn it by doing it, right?
Yes.
Nose a few times.
Yes, but the nice thing is you don't have to do it all now. You don't have to do it all at once. You can take steps and grow your business slowly. And you can, you know, spread your fingers out in your marketing plan and your networking and so forth slowly. You don't have to look at it and go, there's all these things I have to do, that, you know, 370 page book I got to follow. But it's not true. You know, you only follow one word, one paragraph at a time, and you see how you can work it in at different stages of your business. And, you know, and also if you have to let something go, which is often really difficult for us entrepreneurs to do, if we have to let something go, especially love doing that activity, it doesn't mean we're not necessarily going to go back to it. And I think that's a consolation factor, that we just, be flexible enough that we can say, although we really love doing this and maybe we're having good results with that right now, our focus has to go this way, but we can always come back to that later in our business plan in the future. So don't ever feel like you're closing doors just because you have to sort of pause on something.
Yeah, wonderful. You're already sharing so much advice, you know, for aspiring entrepreneurs. It's wonderful. And you got a lot of experience as well. So nice.
Yes. Yes, so, it's been two and a half decades of working with my husband, and then the 6 years of running my business before that. So yes, and I had done hospitality management. I ran market gardens. I worked with my mom's small farm garden where we specialized in rare and endangered species. And so, you know, finding your special niche that really helps you stand out has been something that I've learned over and over again in whatever genre of business that I've worked in. You got to find where you stand out like a purple snowflake among other, like a snowstorm of your peers.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it sounds and it feels contradictive, right? If you have to niche down, because especially when you're just starting, you know, you want as much business as you want. But if you want to help everybody, you're actually helping nobody, because you don't give them a reason why they should come to you.
Right.
So, and niching down. I had a coach who said, he said it's wonderful, you know, do you want to fish in a pond and catch all the fish that's in there? Or do you want to fish in the ocean hoping that one will bite?
Right.
And you're not even sure if the one that will bite is the right one for you.
Right. That's the thing. Yeah. Diversifying is one thing, but also you want to have your special niches. That is absolutely, that is so very true. You know, I had some really excellent responses to a marketing campaign that I doubled down on with the cookbook that just got released, because this particular book opened up a niche in our region. Our particular community, our area of Canada, has like this very powerful food, food hub, I guess you'd call it. Yeah. And so there's a myriad of organizations and they're all connected and networking and interacting. And it's just amazing here. And so as such, we have a lot of festivals and nonprofits and, you know, all kinds of things going on. So I connected with a farmers market and I asked them, would you guys like to do a fundraiser for, you know, to help you improve your market there, and you guys could sell our cookbook right at the info booth. So they did that for a full year last year, full season. We just completed that project, and that was excellent. They got 25% of the sales, so it was good for them, it was good for us, it was excellent. We got great promotion with all the foot traffic walking by, you know, seeing that over and over. So it was great for us. Didn't have to have it yet, had to pay any advertising locally. Our name is spread out so wide now. Another thing that we did recently that was just an amazing underground sort of marketing activity was we got involved with a local thrift store. Now, this thrift store does fantastic work for the community. They take all these donated items, they, you know, fix them up, clean them up, sell them, and then all that goes back into the community and supports dozens of community organizations, women's running from difficult situations like women's shelters or houses got burned down, and they'll come in and give them the furniture they need. They're just an amazing part of the community. And so I happen to know the manager, and I spoke with her. I said, would you like to do just a giveaway of three of our cookbooks? We'll sign them, put some bookmarks in there, do something nice and brighten someone's day, was all I was thinking. Brighten her day, brighten someone else's day. Yeah. And so they decided, the board got together, they decided that they were going to then do a month-long contest, a draw. They set up this table, the stand, they put posters, they did this whole social networking, you know, campaign about it for the local area and all the local Facebook groups. And then, you know, our book was one of the prizes that was available. And so we ended up getting a month long, you know, amount of wonderful advertising, and gives everyone that has any kind of connection with our name, they're now going to see us as like a community-minded, socially responsible, right? So all of that imagery that you're aiming for all the time is happening just by collaborating with nonprofits in your area, just doing simple things. Like if they're having an event, maybe you could donate something for their door prize, or maybe you can network in some other way. Maybe you don't have a book, but you can network in some other way with them. And it's just phenomenal the amount of response that you get from that. It really is.
Yeah. I truly believe that. And the beauty of it is, you didn't mention it, but you're giving without expecting anything in return.
Correct.
Right? You're just giving. And I love that concept because I believe that what you give will return to you somehow. Right?
Right.
And you just give it to help somebody, you know, to make their days more positive, more enlightened. You want to do something good for the community and it comes back to you. And it's wonderful.
It really is. It really is. And just the word of mouth that happened and, you know, all the foot traffic. And as I say, you know, we haven't had to put out ads locally since we moved here. We've been basically running networking operations as opposed to paid advertising to get the word out here locally. Initially, I believe when we first moved here, the first year or two, we did do paid advertising through the local magazines and so forth. But after that, we were getting so much coverage and so much networking opportunities that we haven't felt like we needed to do that here locally.
Perfect. Yeah. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. So, about the radio shows, you also did host online radio shows. Yes. How was that for you? What inspired you to do that? Because it's different than writing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. You know, actually, it was other radio show hosts, you know, from being on the radio a lot at the time. I'm still in the media a lot, maybe 120, 180 times a year, but not anywhere near like I used to be. Mm-hmm. And so at the time, the hosts were telling me, you're actually very comfortable on the mic. You should think about maybe hosting or getting involved in some way. And eventually I ended up getting this opportunity to host a radio show. And I called it Conscious Discussions. And of course, I wanted to focus on having a positive impact. So I ended up interviewing people from around the world. I had people from France and Germany and Australia and Canada and the US, all over the place, who came in to talk about what they were doing to make the world a better place. And it was incredible experience. I loved it. Erwin, I loved it. It was 3 days a week, an hour every time, fresh content every time it aired. And it was 2005 through 2015, I believe that it was that it aired. And I ran it so dedicated for that time, but it involves so much work and so much of my time that I found myself pulled too far, pulled too thin. And with the move to our new location and a house that needed some upgrades, it was too much for me to do all at once. And so I ended up setting that aside. I have a fantasy in my mind that I might go back to it someday, but I haven't gone back there yet. It was such a passion of mine. I absolutely love doing that radio show.
I totally get what you're saying, because I feel the same doing these interviews as well. You know, right. I get to interview people talking about the passion, you know, and I can feel the energy and it energizes myself as well. So I totally get what you're saying.
Absolutely.
And I must say that airing three times a week, that's absolutely dedication for 10 years. Wow.
Yes. Yes. It was a long stint, that's for sure.
Yeah. Wow. Nice. Could you have ever imagined to get that far, to host it for 10 years?
No, when I first started, I didn't imagine that at all. I didn't even know if it was going to take off. I didn't have a lot of confidence in my skills. It was all very new to me. So when I was going through it, I ended up developing all these amazing skills that I had no idea that was going to be it was like going to university. You know, I learned how to prepare contingency shows, how to deal with all kinds of issues, technical issues that can come up, you know, switchboard, everything's, you know, all these things that can happen, call in, somebody's maybe nasty in the chat room. What do you do about that? There's all this stuff going on behind the scenes while you're live, while you're talking and holding this communication. And, you know, what if the guest doesn't show up? And so I had to learn all of these really interesting skills that kept me on my toes. It gave me a lot more confidence about my voice, my ability to communicate. It gave me more ease for doing programs like this. I learned so much from it. It was a great experience.
Nice. And did you get used to hearing your own voice?
Yes.
Because I know it's totally different when I hear myself talk and I hear a recording of my own voice. I think that's not me. Well, I know it's me, but it doesn't sound like me.
Oh, it totally sounds different to me too when I hear my voice. A little bit nasalier than I thought it would be, but you know.
Yeah.
There it is.
There it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have to do with it. Nice. And you got two wonderful dogs as well, I see.
Yes.
So how do you combine your business with your private life? Because you have to walk the dogs, you know, you have to take care of them. So is it easy for you to combine all those things?
I compartmentalize. I sort of section off my day. So it's highly dependent on Dave's schedule. Mm-hmm. And any bookings that we might have. But pending that, I'm going to be, you know, spending a certain amount of time in the office, and then I'll stop because of the accident, I have difficulty holding any one position for an extended period of time.
Yeah.
So I find that I'm getting up often anyway. So I'll take those breaks. I'll go do the dishes, or I'll, you know, go work in the gardens, or I'll, you know, take care of the dogs, or, you know, they're constantly needing to go in and out or on the deck or something anyway. So, you know, they keep me getting up and down a lot anyway. But I find that is actually quite helpful for my business, because I tend to get tunneled, and I really do. Just the other day I was working on a manuscript for an upcoming book coming up in 23-24 time period. And I'm not kidding, I zoned out for 4.5 hours sitting here. I was so cramped. I didn't even realize that I was cramping up. You know, the girls were telling me, you know, this is enough now, you know, we need our attention. And they were so good. They slept the whole time. They were zonked right out. I had them tired. And so they told me, no, it's time. And so I got up and I moved forward. If they didn't have to go out to the bathroom and, you know, wake up from their sleep and say, we got to go, I don't know that I would have taken that break at that moment in time. And maybe I would have been into the real heavy meds that night because I pushed it too far, you know? It's really helpful for me to do that. I find that, like, of course, winter, I do a lot more writing. Fall and spring, I tend to do a lot more in the media. Summer, I tend to spend a lot more time, of course, in the gardens, processing food. You know, about 60, maybe 70% of our vegetables and fruits and nuts are produced right here in our double lot in town. And we are able to do that with that. And so it keeps me really busy in the summer, taking care of those things and, you know, refilling those freezers and cupboards and things. So I do have these sections and times where I sort of ebb and flow as to what I can and cannot focus on. But it's a long day. My days are typically 10-12 hour days, typically, from start to finish, but I'm taking breaks often, you know, every hour and a half. The girls usually don't let me focus like I did that one time. Usually it's every hour, hour and a half, they need something. So that's good. That gets me up. It helps me clear my mind too. So I can think. I haven't actually left the office behind, even though I'm doing work around the house or I'm working in the garden. It gives my mind to sort of like digest it. And it's almost meditative doing these mundane chores. I start thinking about, oh, how am I going to word this, you know, next communication, or how do I deal with this difficult situation that I'm facing and in a way that, you know, emotions aren't going to be an issue or something like that. And it helps me take some scrambly thoughts and sort of bring it down. And I come back to the office just more centered. and ready to go. You know, I've got my hands ready. They're ready to go on that keyboard. Yeah.
Perfect. And it totally makes sense because, you know, you're letting your subconscious come with the answers you're struggling with, right? And if you keep struggling consciously on certain items, certain challenges, it's hard to find the answer. But if you have to take a break, you know, walking the dogs or doing the dishes or whatever, you're not thinking about it, the subconscious will come with the solution because it's an open end and your subconscious doesn't like open endings. So when you take that forced break, so to speak, and you return to your desk, then most of the times you get the answer you're looking for.
That is so true. And it'll come out of the blue sometimes, you know. Yeah, it might be a chapter that I'm working on or an article. Recently, I had an article that was assigned to me and I was just, geez, how am I going to? Okay, so when I'm taking on writing projects, sometimes I'll be asked to write about a certain topic multiple times from different sources over a certain amount of period of time. For me, my challenge is now, how do I make each piece unique and sharing different information? Because I don't want to repeat.
No, of course.
For one thing, I'm going to be sending my traffic there, my contacts, and I don't want them to be getting bored by the things that I'm sending them to because it's the same old, right?
Yeah.
So also I want the media to feel like they're getting something fresh from me. So when I'm assigned something like that, sometimes it can be a challenge as to shut down all the thoughts and to fine tune it and focus into this one area. I don't want to call them voices because it's going to sound like I've got mental issues, but let's call them voices. All of these ideas, these voices are there and they're chatting away. And when you take that time, the monkey mind sort of settles down and that focus happens. And sometimes it's miraculous in a way, you know, you just all of a sudden, boom, you've got it. You know exactly where you're going to take this project or this idea or maybe a discussion that you want to have with your partner because now you've come up with this great opportunity or this thought. It's really interesting how your brain works. Water is amazing for me. Fountains going on in the garden or yard or sitting beside or being near a creek or a lake or a river. Those sounds, I don't know what it is about the sound of running water or trickling water. It is so calming and centering. There's just, I don't know, it's something about that.
I know. I got a little fountain in my office as well. So I know exactly what you mean.
I'm jealous.
Yeah. So, Lillian, I think we can continue for hours talking on our own passion. And it's wonderful to hear you talking about it, seeing and feeling the energy as well. What do you have, since you said that your main focus is to inspire hope in individuals, you know, and helping people realize the value of their efforts and encouraging them to become more positive and proactive?
Yes.
Is there a certain story of example of somebody that you helped, well, almost transforming their life? Or did you get any feedback from that person and you think, wow, it's all been worth it, what we're doing?
Yes. So frequently, I feel really privileged to be able to communicate with the people that are affected by the stuff that we're putting out there in the world. Mm-hmm. And to know that someone is inspired to start gardening. Someone is inspired to start shopping from local food producers and thereby reducing the fossil fuel and you know, the environmental damaging aspects of what is on their plate because they're shopping more locally. They're buying from their local farmers. There might be someone who, the one story I always like to share, I was doing an interview and after the interview, I was contacted by one of the people who listened to the show. It was terrestrial radio on air. And so she was in her car. I don't know where she was traveling from or to, but she was passing by a volunteer organization. We happened to be talking about being proactive, getting involved socially in this discussion. And so she was inspired by that as she's driving along her way. She took that turn. She went in, she signed herself up. And then she started into the volunteering. She said that the volunteering experiences evolved her life, and she was able to include her children and her family in her experiences, took her kids a couple times to different volunteer activities. It totally changed their family dynamics, possibly their children's outlook on, social classes and what have you. Who knows where it went from there? But just to hear that just one person did one thing in their life that changed, it can be the smallest thing, but then the ripple effect of what, could have happened from them taking on that skill is just such an amazing thought, and every day, we have hundreds of thousands of people that visit our blogs and our various activities that we're doing online. And so I always get excited by that, because I think, here's another chance that I could possibly inspire someone else to create positive change in their life and have these wonderful ripple effects of society evolving. It already is evolving, and we're just, getting involved and helping it evolve a little better and a little bit faster.
Right. Yeah. Wonderful example as well of, and it's indeed, you never know what the ripple effect will be of the information and knowledge and experience that you're sharing.
Yeah.
If it just sparks one person, it can already be worth it. So you never know how it goes. So wonderful.
So I had a reader who read one of our poetry books, the Towards Understanding book. Mm-hmm. And that book is actually telling my emotional healing journey of coming out of an abusive broken past and being on my own young. And the mother bought this book for her son who had gone through abuse, and he had never talked about it with her. And after he read the book, they sat down and they had a conversation about what happened. It was tearful, it was emotional, it was harsh, it was traumatic, it was wonderful, it was bonding. And to know that that book had that impact on that one family, and that's just who you hear from. There's perhaps thousands out there that we don't hear back from. That's such a wonderful thought, that we have this chance. Every moment, every breath is a chance to make a difference in the world, to impact someone.
My wife and I wrote a little ebook as well. It's called Healing Stories. Excellent. It's about how you can tell a story to your child and help the child overcome a certain challenge. Right. And we have three example stories in there, and we also explain the stories, and there's like a guideline how you can create your own story that connects with your child even better. Right. We wrote this I think back in 2016, and we now and then we sell one of the books. Mm-hmm. And actually this week my wife got a message from one of the buyers that one of the example stories we used was about the ninja. Uh-huh. And it clicked so much with her son that she wanted to shout it off all the roofs, right? She was so happy and grateful that she bought the book. And it confirms that it's already changing one life, and it was already worth it. And it's so beautiful if you get those responses from people that bought your book.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I think it helps us understand just how easy it is to participate in making the world a better place. One comment, one thought, one glance across the room from your colleagues, sending some positive, supportive thoughts to them when maybe you can see that they're feeling down or tired, or, little actions, little thoughts, little comments. We're always inspiring and influencing people and having an impact all around us. And it's really up to us to decide what kind of impact we're going to have. And if we make that conscious, decision that it's going to be a positive impact, it becomes this goal to go out and, how much positivity can we create in the world today? And sometimes it's just reframing how we're thinking about our position. Maybe we're working a mundane job that we absolutely don't like, but here it gives us an opportunity with the clients, the customers coming into us. Maybe we can make that our goal. We're going to brighten each customer's day. We're going to try to improve their day. Never mind about ourselves right now. We're going to focus on someone else. When we take ourselves out of the picture, I think it I don't know, our inner dialogue seems to sort of shut down. We stop second guessing who we are. Our inner saboteur, our inner judge, our inner critic starts to quiet down a little bit. It opens up new possibilities. We develop all these great relationships. Your life will never be the same.
Yeah, wonderful, wonderful. So this is already a great piece of advice that you're sharing with the audience. Do you maybe have one little tip or piece of wisdom you would like to share with aspiring entrepreneurs that would like to follow their passion but are a bit afraid or procrastinating on that subject?
Feel the fear and do it anyway. It's always going to be scary. Everything you do. We've been in this business 2.5 years. Every time we launch something new, it's always scary. It's always a little unsettling at the very least. And we do it anyway. Don't be afraid to not have the skills or not have the experience. That's okay. Most of us didn't when we started. And there's a lot of things out there that I have yet to learn, you know, and sometimes it can be overwhelming and intimidating, but I try to just take it as one day at a time. This day, I'm going to do these things. This week, I'm going to do these things that are going to lead up to my action plan for next year. You know, there are steps that you have to take that maybe you'll be slow steps. Be patient with the process. Allow the process to happen. Be patient with yourself. And again, know that you're not going to be at your best every single day. So give yourself a break, but do it anyway. Find those mentors. Get out there and get the education that you need. It's out there. It's at your fingertips. All you need to do is do it.
Yeah, wonderful, wonderful advice. It reminds me when I started back 7 years ago, and during my hypnotherapy training, I was with my one of the other students, which is now one of my best friends. And we did an exercise, and he was telling me that he saw his practice, you know, but before he started, he wanted to finish this the training we were on, the advanced training. He had some other trainings he wanted to follow, and then he had enough skills, in his opinion, to help the clients the best he could.
Right.
And I just asked him the question, okay, well, that's great. You know, when do you have enough knowledge to start?
Right.
And it totally shut him down. He thought that he was silent for a few seconds, almost a minute or so. I said, I guess when I finish this training, I said, you're right. And he just started as well. So
that's right. You know, you're going to be learning all the time. And just taking the baby steps. Yeah. Learn from those who have done before you. You don't have to reinvent the wheel, you know, go and learn from people who have already set out the plans and the process for you, tweak it to suit your unique situation and move forward from there. Have plans, do your marketing plan, do your action plan, hold yourself accountable. Don't be lazy. You know, face reality. It is going to take some work, and you're the one who has to do the work. There's no one else that can do it for you. Exactly. Unless you're very wealthy and can outsource. So most of the time it's in your own hands. And so that means you got to put the time in to learn the skills, but that's okay. It's okay.
And don't be afraid to ask.
Right.
Right.
Oh, I have had such great results from joining entrepreneur groups and business groups and author groups. And, you know, you come across an issue or a question, something you haven't tried before. You know, you think, geez, I wonder what they're going to think of me. If I ask this question, they might think differently of me. Do it anyway. Ask your question. People are so helpful and so willing to share their what they have learned. And I absolutely recommend that. Just recently, I put out a call on one of a few of our author groups. And I said, just a simple, hey, would you like to stop by our brand new little YouTube channel and maybe subscribe or like what we're doing? Give us a hand, you know? And it was worded more nicely than that. But the response from that quick little, would you possibly help us out, friends, because we have been on that group and they know us already. We had such a great response from that and lots of wonderful feedback and, you know, a few more subscribers to our YouTube and lots of likes and things like that. A lot more views that week just from putting out that little thing, you know, just, hey, would you do this? So being involved in those groups and asking a question and, last year when I was releasing those books, I was on a couple of publisher blogger type groups. And I said, does anybody there have a podcast or a blog or a vlog or what have you that accepts guests? And if so, I would love to apply. The feedback I got back from that post, I don't know, 40, 50, 55 different comments about people offering me positions to come on and, you know, send a submission to be on their show. So yeah. You never know where a simple little question is going to take you.
Exactly. I had the same with this podcast, you know, I just posted on the Hero. I asked, you know, I'm starting this new podcast. I'm looking for entrepreneurs that are following the passion and make a living out of it. If you want to be my guest, please respond. And I got over 80 responses. And just it's wonderful. Like I just hear it, and it's all over the place. You know, I got so many different entrepreneurs that are following so many different passions. And they're all passionate about it. And that's the beauty of it.
Yes.
And I also, during my trainings, I always say, you know, there's no such thing as a stupid question. The only question that exists is the one not asked.
Excellent. That is so true. That is so absolutely true, because it's going to hold us back. You know, it really will if we don't ask those questions. And, you know, as I say, people are so willing to give advice. You know, get on those forums, get on those groups, networking groups, fantastic places to go for help and advice as well.
Definitely. Definitely. So Lilian, if people want to know more about you or Dave, of course, how can they contact you?
Okay. Our main website is brummetmedia.ca. That's brummetmedia.ca, brummetmedia.ca. Mm-hmm. And, or they can just do an internet search, go on their favorite search engine and type in Lilian and Dave Brummet. Make sure you spell her last name right. It's Brummet. Some people get that backwards, two T's, one M. It's two M's, one T. Yeah. And so pages of information will come up about, you know, different social networking sites and our blogs and all of that should show up there. The very first thing you see should be our main website, which is brummetmedia.ca.
Perfect. Perfect. I must say, Lilian, I really loved our conversation. I know we could have talked for hours. Maybe we should plan another episode.
I would love that.
Yeah. But I really loved our conversation. You know, I wish you all the best. Hi to Dave for me. And let's keep in touch.
Yes, please. Yes, that would be nice.